Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory. Teach us, Lord, full obedience, holy reverence, true humility. Cause our faith to rise, cause our eyes to see your majestic love and authority. Words of power that can never fail, let the truth prevail over unbelief. Speak, O Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory.
A blessed good morning, brothers and sisters. 2 weeks ago, Brother Lee shared about knowing God's will. G Wisdom was the acronym used. The first part was about knowing God's will through the Heavenly Father, which is the G. The Son through the Word, which is the W. And I, which refers to the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Now, we are going to tackle the second part, but before that, I'd like to read you the Bible verse for today, which is the same as the last time, which is found in Romans 12, 1 and 2. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Have you encountered God's leading through the circumstances that you are in? Or maybe, all of a sudden, someone in your care group shared something that's related to your situation and hit you right there. or maybe a fellow believer giving you an advice. Let's see how God can use all these things to help us know His will. Just remember, God's will is good for us even if we don't like it. It's perfect even if we don't agree. His will be done even if we don't conform to it. And in most cases, we will struggle until His will is fulfilled. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity once again to come today and to listen to your word. Father, may you bless the speaker, bless the audiences, the brothers and sisters who are seeking your word, the lessons for today. Father, we pray that everyone would truly be enlightened by knowing your will. We commit to you our time in your hands. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. When I share topic with a multiple series, I would usually skip for a month before I move to the second one. Now, later on, I've received feedback from the brothers and sisters asking me, why do you have to wait for a month before going on to the next part? They say that by the time I share part two, they have already forgotten all about part one. So, God be willing, I will share part two this morning on the topic, the will to God's good and perfect will. Remember, last time we shared about that God reveals His will through the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. G is for God. Go to God in prayer. When we come before the Lord to seek His will, you have to come with a humble heart. Confess your sin, ask for His forgiveness, then lay down your plan before Him and let Him lead you to His will, whether it is your will or not. Okay, W, search His word. Let the scripture be the parameter of His righteousness. If His word says yes, let it be yes. If His word says life, let it be life. If the word says death, let it be death. If His word says blessing, let it be blessing. If the word says curse, let it be curse. Don't try to manipulate the word of God and don't try to interpret it out of context, because doing so is from the evil one. Next is letter I. We have to heed to His indwelling spirit. Brothers and sisters, this part is a tricky one, because sometimes we could not discern whether what we feel is from our conscience or from the Holy Spirit or from our old sinful flesh. After the 2 weeks ago, after the message, somebody asked me, he said, how can I tell if it's my conscience or conviction from the Holy Spirit? And then he said, if I decide on things with a clear conscience, is it okay? Is it the will of God? Brothers and sisters, allow me to share with you a scripture. According to the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 9, verse 1, he said, with Christ as my witness, I speak with utter truthfulness, and my conscience and the Holy Spirit confirms it. So, brothers and sisters, our conscience and the Holy Spirit should work together to confirm each other. For instance, you can say, oh, I have a clear conscience. If it agrees with the Bible, yes, indeed, that is a good conscience. However, even if you say you have a clear conscience, but if it doesn't agree with the Bible, brothers and sisters, your conscience has already been seared. Okay, another instance. If you say there is peace in my heart, and if it agrees with the Bible, yes, that is the peace from the Holy Spirit. However, If you say there's peace in your heart, but it is against the teaching of the Bible, brothers and sisters, that kind of peace is from your flesh. It is not from the Holy Spirit, because you have already grieved the Holy Spirit or already quenched the Holy Spirit. Anyway, just to be sure, if you have, say you have clear conscience, be sure that it agrees with the teaching of the Scripture. And if it is, then you can clearly say that peace that you have in your heart comes from the Holy Spirit. In other words, just remember Romans 9:1. It says, with Christ as my witness, I speak with utter truthfulness, my conscience and Holy Spirit confirms it. That is in accordance to the teaching of the Apostle Paul. Now, let us move on to the four steps. There is a Chinese saying, Din Su But, people, surroundings, and things. God often speaks to us or reveals His will to us through three elements. It's either people, surrounding, or things. Okay, so let's move on to the fourth steps. Letter S. We have to observe the surroundings. And the fifth step is we have to deliberate with the mind of Christ. And the sixth, we have to consider the other people in our life. And lastly, but not the least, we have to have fellowship with man of God. Now, what does it mean to observe the surroundings? Brothers and sisters, God often speaks to us or reveals His will to us through our surrounding. So we have to observe what is happening around us. There are four more ways God speaks to His people, and this is one of them. We have to review the situation that's happening day by day, all around us. What is it all about? Is God talking to you? You can pray and ask, God, is that you who is whispering to me something, leading me to your will, or stopping me from something evil? Brothers and sisters, this is quite a tricky one also, because sometimes people tend to manipulate such thing. Okay, there is a very popular story about the fleece of Gideon. I'm sure many of you, most of you are familiar with this story, but for the sake of those who are not familiar with the story of Gideon, allow me to briefly read the verse for you. Judges 6:36-40. Gideon was called by God to fight against the enemy of Israel and rescue them, save them. But Gideon was a very humble person. Gideon said, no, I can't do it. I'm weak and I belong to a very weak clan. I can't do it. But God said, I will be with you. Then Gideon said to God, if you are truly going to use me to rescue Israel, prove it to me in this way. And Gideon set the conditions. First, he said, I will put a wool fleece on the threshing floor tonight. If the fleece is wet with dew in the morning, but the ground is dry, then I will know that you are going to help me to rescue Israel. And that evening, that is what he did. And the following morning, it came about as what God has promised. Then Gideon was not very convinced yet. Gideon said, please do not be mad at me. Let me use the fleece for one more test. One na lang, okay. He said, this time, let the fleece remain dry while the ground around is wet with dew, okay? And so That night, God did as Gideon asked, and the fleece was dry in the morning, but the ground was covered with dew. Brothers and sisters, today, maybe sometimes God will allow us to test His will or His leading, but not always. Also, if you look at the situation in Gideon, it was a special case, something that was impossible, but God made it into something that becomes possible. So, brothers and sisters, do not abuse this method, or do not make a fool out of the Lord, or doing something foolish. Allow me to explain about this matter. For instance, your dream is to have this luxurious car for many years already, but it costs more than 5 years of your salary to buy it. And you keep on praying and praying and praying and praying, and you saw on the newspaper that is on sale, 50% off. But even at 50% off, it will still take you many years to buy that car. But you say, I will pray to the Lord. I will seek His will. I will pray. And then you pray, Lord, if it is your will, let that model be on display at the showroom tomorrow. Whether I have the money or not, I claim your promise that it is your will. I claim your promise that you will supply the money for me. Brothers and sisters, do not despise the Lord. The Lord is not as gullible as we are. Okay, now here's another example. You are so much in love with each other. And the lovers, they call each other every day, especially on Saturday evening. But you were one, are you sure that it is God's will for the two of you to get married? And the girl says, I have been praying for it, and the Lord always confirmed His will. Like He said, she would pray, He said, Lord, if this guy calls me before midnight this Saturday, then He is your will for me. Yung pala, every Saturday night, the guy is calling her. How about the guys? The guys would say, because the girl was so anxious, so excited to receive his call, just for the first ring, the girl would immediately answer the phone. But the guy said, Lord, if He answers my call on the third ring, seize Your will for me. Of course, when he calls, hindi pa third ring, first ring pa lang, angat ka agad. And said, Lord, thank You, Lord, that is Your will. Brothers and sisters, you have to pray and say, Lord, speak to me now. Let me know Your will. I'm done trying to manipulate You. Instead, may Your will be done in my life. Brothers and sisters, almost 6 months ago, during our meeting between elders and the deacons, we were thinking of holding a year-end special conference, end of the year. We are thinking of inviting Pastor David Goh of Grace Christian Gospel. You might ask, actually somebody has already asked last Sunday, why did we invite Pastor David Goh? Why don't we invite Brother Jonathan Pong or somebody else abroad? Brothers and sisters, as we have fellowship together, we are thinking of during the holiday season, maybe we will allow the congregation to listen to something lighter, something more applicable, and it's not too deep doctrine. So we thought Brother Pastor David Goh would be very suitable for this conference. Kasi yung mga heavyweight like Christian Chen, Stephen Kong, the Dana Kongdon, those are heavy, those are deep spiritual doctrines. Those are reserved for summer conference, okay? So let's have something light this holiday. Okay, actually, but we do not know if Pastor David Goh will be available, because I know in those days, during those days, he had an eye surgery, and it had some complication, and he has to keep on going back to the surgeon. Another thing is Pastor David Goh, though he's already a retired pastor in Grace Gospel, yet he's very busy. Before the pandemic, he would go to India many times a year to train the missionaries there on how to share the gospel, how to disciple the people there. And even now, during the pandemic, he's still very busy because he continuously trained not only missionaries, but even preachers via online. So anyway, so we have decided to bring the matter in prayer and in fellowship. We said, okay, we will pray for 1 week, and the next Lord's Day, we will talk about it. We will have fellowship and share what the Lord has given to us, spoken to us, and lead us to His will. You know, Pastor David Goh, I've known him for more than 30 years when I was running a Christian bookstore. But during all these 30 years, and even now, most of the time, I am the one who would bother him, who would call me up, who would call him up, asking him about Bible controversies, asking about church policies, asking about all sorts of problems, even a prayer request. He never called me up. He never bothered me. Ako ang lagi nag-istorbo sa kanya. What a kinitsain lang. Iimpat kalay, tsagwa lang. But anyway, so we said, we will pray for God to open the door, to lead us to His will, whether He wants Pastor David Goh to speak in our midst or not. That was the Lord's Day, Sunday. Then on Wednesday, I received a Viber message from Pastor David Goh. Early in the morning, usually when we would Viber each other, it should be early evening or late morning. But that morning, on Wednesday, 6:15 in the morning, he Vibered me. I thought it was an emergency. We do not Viber each other at 6 in the morning unless it is a daily devotion. And he said, good morning, Pastor Joey. May I know what is your church policy stand on remarriage or those who are divorced, annulled, separated? We are currently writing our manual and want to include a statement on that so that we are looking at how other churches deal with this. Thanks. Wow, I was surprised. I should be the one to ask him about the policies, about church policies. And out of the blues, first time in my life, in our relationship with him, that he would ask me about our church. I thought, perhaps the Lord is hinting, opening the way for me to ask him. Because earlier than that, after the meeting on Monday, I told Brother Jackson, I will not call up Pastor David Goh. Because we are praying. We should keep quiet. We should not move. Let God be the one to open the door. And Brother Jackson says he agrees. He said, okay, don't call Pastor David Goh. I did not call him, but on Wednesday, he called me. So I thought, maybe God is opening the door a little. So, but I kept myself I stopped myself from telling him about the conference. So I prayed, Lord, if you're opening the door, please let me know. Let me know your will. I did not bring the matter to him on Wednesday. And on Thursday, I thought, well, maybe it's about time. I will ask, Lord, let your will be done. So I vibrated him, said, good morning, Goboksu. I know you're very busy and it's a long shot, but it's worth trying. I said, we are planning to have an online year-end special conference live via Zoom. May we invite you to be our guest speaker for the 3-session event? After a few minutes, he answered, wow! Brothers and sisters, he said, wow! What a privilege! Thanks for the opportunity. Can you give me 3 or 4 days to pray about it? I will give you an answer on or about Monday. On the following Lord's Day, this was what I reported to Brother Jackson and the other deacons. I said, this is what happened. The Lord seems to open the way, but we do not know. Let us wait for the Lord to reveal His perfect will on Monday. Not tonight, not that night, but on Monday. And brothers and sisters, as you all know, God has opened the way. God has revealed His will. That's why we are going to hold our year-end conference this December. The topic is hand-in-hand, heart-to-heart, shoulder-to-shoulder by Pastor David Goh. For your information, he is a formerly senior pastor of Grace Christian Gospel, now serving as missions pastor and the head of Grace Strengthening Mission. He is on his training ministry, not only teaching preachers, not only teaching pastors, but also teaching, going on mission and teaching missionaries. Now, let's move on to D. Deliberate the pros and cons. Brothers and sisters, when we seek the Lord, we do not just pray and leave everything to Him and do nothing and sit and wait and wait and wait. Brothers and sisters, the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 16 says, we have the mind of Christ. Do you know that, brothers and sisters? Believe it or not. The Bible says we have the mind of Christ. If you don't believe it, you open your Bible, you search your Bible, 1 Corinthians 2:16. Brothers and sisters, all believers, even in different degrees, God has already given us the mind of Christ. Why? Because on the day we are saved, on the day we accept Jesus as our Savior, the Holy Spirit dwells in us, and the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, and the wisdom of Christ is in us. Now, it depends how intimate your relationship is with Christ. If you have very intimate relationship with Christ, then you really have great wisdom in Christ. You have the mind of Christ. There's also a promise, James chapter 1, verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach. Brothers and sisters, thank the Lord. This is a very, very good promise, but sadly, many Christians fail to do it. If you lack wisdom, what should you do? Be humble enough. Tell the Lord that you are bobo. You lack wisdom. And tell the Lord you need wisdom from Him. And you claim that promise, and He shall give it to you generously and without reproach. Now, you need the mind of Christ, and you need the wisdom of God in order to be able to wait out or to deliberate on that particular matter, whether it is good or bad. Or you should weigh the pros and cons. I will give an example. A few months ago, we were considering resuming the physical gatherings on alternative level 2, meaning when the government announced alert level 2, then some churches might start opening their meeting hall to mass gathering. Should we do the same or not? So in our discussion, we have this pros and cons. We deliberate on this matter because this is a very important matter. It does not only involve the spiritual condition of the people, but it also involves the life and death of those who will be attending. What's the pros? What is the advantage if we open if we open the physical gathering of our church? First, good thing is it creates a physical expression of the unity of God's people. We can express each other and say hi, hello, and have fellowship online, major limited. And it will also make the spirit of the Lord's Supper and worship more meaningful. What do you do these days? We just do it at home. And I do not know, while we're doing the Lord's Supper, some people were they were just sleeping. And some were just watching the news or what, while we do the Lord's Supper. And we do not have the opportunity to open your mouth and to sing praises and to praise and worship Him. Opening the assuming the physical gathering will make the spirit of Lord's Supper more meaningful. Thirdly, it will restore the scripture-based church meeting format, which is gathering physically together. And lastly, but not the least, it gives members who do not have internet the opportunity to attend the service regularly. Brothers and sisters, we are sad that some members, because of lack of technology or because they do not know how to use the internet or they don't even have the gadget, they are not able to attend the church meeting for already 2 years. So if we resume the physical gathering, then they will be able to have spiritual feeding. These are the pros. These are the advantages. These are the good things if we resume physical gathering. However, we have also made research on what preparations we need to do, and these are the cons. First, we know the drop in alert level may just be to boost the poor economy. We expect even December it might drop to level 1, but are you sure that the pandemic is gone? Maybe everybody, the government knows that everybody is poor and hungry and everybody wants to celebrate Christmas, so they drop the level to 1. We do not know. So we have to be very careful. Number 2. The tedious physical arrangement and safety protocol and manpower required in order to open or to resume the physical gathering. Number 3, there is still high risk of exposure to the virus in spite of the safety measures that we will be preparing. And number 4, some families cannot attend together due to restrictions because even if they have opened a physical gathering, there might be some restrictions that from age to age you can go, you can attend. From age to age you cannot attend. Or if you are fully vaccinated, you can attend. If you are not fully vaccinated or not, you know, you can attend. And there are so many restrictions. So chances are the families cannot attend the service physically all together. Some might go to CGCQC and some might have to stay. So it divides the family instead of uniting the family together in the Lord. And therefore, we feel that the benefits on expected number of attendees do not justify the risk and the preparation. So, brothers and sisters, level two, we have decided not to resume physical gatherings yet. Okay, now let's move on to letter O. Consider the other people in your life. The words of God says, Philippians chapter 2, verse 4, let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others. Brothers and sisters, if you plan to do something, especially something that will affect other members of your family, you better discuss the matter with them. For instance, you are the wage earner in the family, and both your father and your mother are very old. They depend on you for support. And suddenly you said, oh, I want to, for the advancement of my future, I will go somewhere abroad. And I will just leave, I love you, dad, mom and dad, I love you. I will pay for the yonglo, home for the aged, something like that. Brothers and sisters, before you decide on something, when you come before the Lord for his leading, you have to have fellowship with the people close to you, especially members of your family. And not only members of your family, even your friend. Will your action have something to do with their condition, their being? Will it affect them? So, brothers and sisters, first, you have to consider the other people. Also, it comes in both ways. First, you have to think about the other people, how it will affect, how your move will affect other people. Another part of it is you have to seek counsel. You have to seek counsel. You have to ask advice from people, from other people, especially those people who love you and who wants the best for you. Brothers and sisters, who loves you and who wants the best for you? I'll tell you 100%, it's your parents. Have fellowship with your parents. Have a heart-to-heart talk with them. Whether they're Christian or not, chances are they can share some wisdom from them. Respect them, honor them, and consider their advice for you. Also, you can also have fellowship. Or you can consult your friend, whether they're Christians or not. Some unbelievers, maybe they can give you also very good advice. Okay, of course, preferably, we want you to seek counsel from believers. Just make sure these people are your BFF, best friend forever. You know and you are sure that whatever they want the best for you. You seek counsel for them. Proverbs 15:22 says, without counsel, plans fail, but with many advisors, they succeed. So, brothers and sisters, you have to first consider other people. You have also to seek counsel from, letter O, other people. Another thing is you have to be sensitive to the suggestion or feedbacks of other people. I searched my file and I discovered that I shared this particular topic in 1992. That was 29 years ago when I was seeking the Lord's will regarding his calling for me. 15 years later, I received a suggestion. A couple of people suggested to me again. Well, they asked me first on regarding looking for the will, and I told them, gee wisdom. They said, Can you share it? We do not know how to apply that G wisdom you're talking about. So 15 years later, I shared the topic again in the pulpit. Another 9 years later, I shared it again because some approached me. I think one approached me that she's planning to work abroad, whether it's God's will or not. But, you know, she has to leave her parents. Both of them are very sickly and this and that. So, again, I said, you look at the G wisdom and said, can you share it? So I shared it again. And then lately, for the past 6 months or almost a year, I keep on receiving questions regarding seeking God's will. As I mentioned, somebody even come to our house, and during our fellowship, when people will ask about this thing, and somebody will say, recently the group leader, then you refer to G wisdom. Then say, I do not know what's G wisdom. You ask Brother Lee. And then some said, Brother Lee, kaya nga, you share the G wisdom na lang. You haven't been sharing it for a long time. Again and again, I also helped the Bible study with another group, and we also encountered that, and they also say, why don't you share G wisdom again, once and for all, so that everybody will know, because just the mere G wisdom, nobody knows what it is about. So I prayed about it, and then more frequently, I received a repetitive request that I should share about this topic. And that's the reason why today I believe that it is the Lord for me to share it again. It is not my habit to share the same topic over and over again, but I feel those who have heard it 29 years ago, during those days, they might be toddlers or babies, but today they might already be married. And even 9 years ago, they have different needs in knowing God's will. So I believe it's God's will that I share the topic again than today, and therefore it's here. Now, brothers and sisters, lastly but not the least, have fellowship with man of God. Usually when you say man of God, we are talking about pastors, elders, or maybe counselor, advisors, or maybe even deacons. This one, I'd like you to be the one to observe the person whom you want to seek advice. They can be pastors, they can be reverend, they can be doctor, they can be whatever, but very, very important is you have to observe the character of that person. And I just would like to share with you a teaching from the Apostle Paul about the quality of the person that you have to seek counsel from. Okay, that's in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 to 7. It says, an overseer, an elder or a pastor must be above reproach, the husband of one wife, sober, meaning hindi lasengo, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach. He must manage his own household well, with all dignity, keeping his children submissive, and he must be well thought of by outsiders. Of course, if that person, whoever he is, whether he's a reverend or pastor or elder or whatever, if he's a drunkard, if he's violent, if he's quarrelsome, if he's a lover of money, then you look for somebody else. I'd like to share with you this experience of mine. I do not know. Well, many of you might know Brother Dana Congdon. He's a pastor in CBM Ministry in New York. Before, he comes here almost every year during summer for the summer conference. Okay. On his last trip, I was driving him to the airport. And on our way to the airport, he said, Jose, I want you to tell Brother Lucas Wu, Brother Wu, okay, ngo ape, that you are ready to speak at the pulpit. What do you think? I look at him, I said, no way. He said, why no way? I said, I'm a sinner. I cannot speak in the pulpit. His face turned red and he got so mad and he shouted at me. He said, then let me off this car. Don't bring me to the airport. I got so scared. I said, why? He said, if you say you are not willing to share God's word because you're a sinner, then I am also not qualified. So leave me here. I will just walk to the airport. I got so scared. Anyway, I drove him to the airport. The next day, I keep on thinking about that. I talked to myself. I said, no way, no way, no way. And on my way to the gasoline station, I got hit by a car. The car was really totally wrecked. The battery was smashed. The radiator was smashed. And even the chassis was disaligned. But not a hair on my head. Or not, walang kagasgas. I got so scared and I told the Lord, Lord, what is it that you want me to do? I will submit. Anyway, I did not immediately go to Brother Wu and say, Brother Wu, Brother Dana Kongdon asked me to ask you to speak in the pulpit. No, I just wait quietly. I said, Lord, your will be done. And then after a few months, he assigned me to speak in the pulpit. And I submitted to him. That was, I think, more than 30 years ago. And brothers and sisters, if the Lord has called you, if you really want to know his will, then you have to be ready to obey him. Otherwise, don't even ask. You will just be wasting your time. Don't say, Lord, reveal your will to me if I like it. If I don't like it, don't reveal it to me. Brothers and sisters, may the Lord be merciful to us. May the Lord give us a humble heart to obey him, to accept his calling in accordance to his will. Go to God in prayer, search his word, heed his indwelling spirit, observe the surroundings, deliberate with the mind of Christ, consider the other people, and lastly, fellowship with the man of God. In this way, then you may know that good and perfect will of God. Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for giving us the opportunity. We can gather together this morning in spite of the pandemic. Thank you, Lord, for the technology that you have provided, that we are here to listen to your word. We just want to pray for each one of us, Lord. May you create in each one of us, in our heart, Lord, not only the hunger and thirst to seek your kingdom and your righteousness, but also may you grant us a willing heart to seek your will, not only to seek your will, but also to know your will and to obey your will. We know how difficult it is, Lord, for us to be willing to offer our life to you. But we also know that this is the one and only way that will please you. You have sacrificed yourself. You have to pay the price of your blood to save us so that we may be set apart from this world, that we may come to you and serve you and be useful to you. We just want to, again, commit each one of us for the coming week. We pray, Lord, may you bless us. May you keep us from all evil. May you make your shining face to be upon us, Lord, and may you grant us grace, and may you grant us peace, the peace that surpasses all understanding, because the peace that comes from you, even in spite of the trials, of the pandemics, of the dangers that we are facing these days. And may our life, this coming week, our testimony, give glory to your name. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Morning. Thank you for joining the CGCQC online worship service. Next Lord's Day at 10 a.m. is our much-awaited first-ever virtual Sunday School Thanksgiving activity. Don't forget to invite your friends and family to join. Together, let us give thanks to the Lord and praise His glorious name. This Friday night, Brother Joseph Wu Jr. continues our study on Chapter 4 as the Apostle Paul wrote additional instructions to Timothy. Do you have frustrating thoughts and struggles on whether life or even God is fair? Join us next Lord's Day and let us learn from Pastor Stephen Tan the biblical perspective about finding fairness in life. It is with great joy that we invite you to our special year-end conference. Let us welcome 2022 hand-in-hand, heart-to-heart, and shoulder-to-shoulder. Here is the schedule for your reference. Our speaker is Pastor David Goh. The Bible teaches us to pray for all people, to make petitions and intercession. Through prayer, let us call to the Lord for our country and our brothers and sisters. Please arrange with your care groups your virtual prayer time weekly. A giving heart is a thankful heart. Give generously and joyfully. You may give your offering online. Here are our bank account details for your reference. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. God bless and keep safe.